This is Adam Marcus, director of Jason Goes to Hell and Secret Santa, and you are listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
Jason X, Chapter 12. And this is how the end begins. Hugging herself, Rowan looked around at everyone else in Lab 1. On an unusual exam table, as far away from the door as possible, Janessa was sitting with the girl who had come in wearing nothing but her underwear and a generous splash of her boyfriend's blood. Her name was Kinsa, Rowan remembered, and her boyfriend had been Stony. Janessa had done her best to calm her down while cleaning off the worst of the blood, and by the time she had finished, the girl's crying had died away. But while her trembling had lessened, it had yet to stop completely. Rowan doubted that it ever would. She thought her own had, but after all, it had been 4.5 centuries since she had so much as shivered in the cold. Although the fact that she had been frozen rigid had been the major contributing factor there. Rowan bit her lower lip against the laughter that threatened to come bubbling up as hysteria from deep inside herself. No, the trembling never did go away altogether when Jason Voorhees was involved. It didn't always show on the outside, but that didn't mean it had stopped. Her gaze fell on Lo, leaning on the table where she had woken up from her long cold sleep. His expression showed that he was being solemn and thoughtful, but that wasn't fooling her. He had probably stood in front of a mirror and practiced for hours until that look of grave concern was absolutely authentic. But he had referred to Jason using the magic word, valuable. He had added scientific artifact to give it the right academic heft, and thus disavow that anything as venal and as greed was a motive. A scientific artifact had significance above and beyond the merely material, but it wasn't his fault if it also happened to make him rich. In the end, though, it always comes down to money. She had said that to him not even an hour ago, thinking she was talking to someone higher up on the evolutionary ladder than that arrogant jackass Wimmer, someone with a conscience guided by an ethical and moral compass with acceptable parameters. Instead, here she was with another jackass as bad as Wimmer, maybe worse, since Wimmer hadn't had a gaggle of college students with him. On the other hand, there was no need to endow Wimmer with any unproved virtues, even in theory. He'd probably just never had a chance to bus any in. Rowan rubbed her eyes, her revulsion for Lo momentarily eclipsing her fear for her own life. 445 years, and human nature had made little, if any, progress towards a more enlightened state. In the end, it always comes down to money. Lo had heard it, not as a warning, but as a motto. We're all screwed, Rowan thought bleakly as her gaze moved on to the other three grouped together around a console. They all looked spooked, even the robot. Android, she corrected herself. It wasn't a robot. It was a knowledge matrix android, hence the name KM. Like it would make any difference. As if sensing her thoughts, the android turned to look at her. Now Rowan found the expression on that smooth, perfect face disturbingly unreadable. She's inscrutable, Rowan thought, thus proving she was telling the truth when she claimed to be real. Nobody can be inscrutable unless they're real. She pressed her lower lip firmly between her teeth just as a precaution, in case hysterical laughter threatened again. Abruptly, a voice came from a speaker in one of the consoles, and Rowan almost jumped out of her skin. But then, so had everyone else in the lab, she saw. Well, except for K.N., who merely sat up a little straighter, where she was perched on the arm of Cineron's chair. She no longer looked inscrutable. "Sarge, we've got a body in Bay 2. K Kensa began to weep again. Kicker could smell it as soon as the doors to Cargo Bay 2 hissed open. The look on Briggs's face said she smelled it too. The heavy, coppery stink that hits you in the back of the throat and puts your gag reflex on half-trigger. Nothing else smelled like blood. Even if you've never smelled it before, you still knew what it was somehow. Instinct, maybe? Or ancestral memory? You knew what it was, and you knew it meant nothing good. He snapped on his flashlight and powered up his weapon. Briggs did the same, and they moved forward into the cargo bay. Kicker signaled for them to spread out. She nodded once, her wide eyes serious and her mouth set in a grim line. How pale she was, Kicker thought suddenly. Briggs was exceptionally fair-haired and fair-skinned anyway, but right now she was practically ghostly. Or cadaverous. The hairs on the back of his neck stood up as a wave of superstitious dread swept through him. Kicker had never been superstitious until he had joined the military, where one of the first things he had learned was that superstition actually aided a soldier in staying alive, and you ignored it at your peril. And if you thought that was all just bullshit, you could go talk to all the grunts who were still walking, talking, and making thanks to hunches and premonitions. Even the odd dream now and then could add an extra couple of days to your life, as long as you didn't ignore them. And then again, sometimes that stuff was only a heads up. Nothing more than advance notice of something you didn't have a hope in hell of avoiding. So you could at least brace yourself, or try to. Briggs moved away from him, the beam from her flashlight sweeping from side to side as she advanced farther into the cargo bay. Kicker made himself do likewise, but he had only made one sweep with his own torch when he saw someone lying on the floor. His heart leaped painfully in his chest as he tapped his comm. "Sarge, we've got a body in Bay 2." The last word was barely out of his mouth when he heard Briggs say, "Oh, shit!" He turned to see her crouching over something crumpled against the wall 20 feet away. "Sarge, I found Dallas," she said.
"Well, where the hell is he?" Brodsky snapped.
"He's dead." She turned her pale face to Kicker.
"Kicker, yours too?"
Brodsky asked, his tone emotionless now. "Roger that," Kicker replied, still feeling for a pulse in spite of himself. "It's Azrael." If he didn't look at anything except the kid's face and the bright circle of light from his torch, Kicker thought, he could have sworn Azrael was really just sleeping. "Sarge, we got a blood trail here," said Sven's voice in his comm. "It's leading towards the cargo bay."
"Yeah, I can tell you where it came from, too," Brodsky replied. "We found the other student casualty, Stoney."
The Sarge sounded mad as hell, Kicker thought, as he continued to gaze at Azrael. It was only when you saw the way the rest of his body was twisted at the waist that the illusion was spoiled. You didn't have to be a doctor to know his back was broken. It was as if he were a toy some nasty, spoiled brat had broken and tossed away without a second thought. He swallowed, noting absently that his throat was tight.
"Okay, listen up," Brodsky went on. "Condor, Kicker, and I will take Cargo Main. The rest of you take Portside. Stay alert. We want some definite payback on his ass. Breach on my command. Got it?"
"Roger that," Kicker murmured. "Time to kill something." He started to get up and then paused. From this angle, he could see only Azrael's face again. God damn it. He was having the worst time making himself believe the kid wasn't just catching a nap between the end of one game and the start of another. Hell, Briggs looked more like a corpse than he did. A hard and heavy hand landed on his shoulder from behind with bruising force. Kicker gave a high-pitched yell and jumped back, at the same time spinning around and raising his weapon, aiming it where he estimated his attacker's groin would be. His attacker stood over him with one hand on her hip, doing her best to look scornful and superior rather than distraught. "Sorry," Briggs said carelessly. "Shit!" Kicker's breath came out in a noisy rush. He took the hand she was offering and let her help him to his feet. "Don't do that." Briggs looked down her nose at him. "You scream like a girl." "Screw you." "You wish." They eyed each other for a second, holding hands tightly. Then, when he was sure his training had reasserted itself, and he wouldn't turn around to look at Azrael again, he let go of Briggs so they could punch each other. "Azrael!" Rowan looked over at Janessa in surprise. The woman had barely whispered the name, much too softly for anyone else to hear. But at the same time, it was very, very loud, incredibly loud, so loud that no one could have missed it. Her pretty face had the terrible, stricken look of someone who was just starting to realize that everything was not going to be all right, but still couldn't quite believe that the universe would really let something seriously bad happen. Like, as you know it is over, Rowan thought at her. Think that's overly harsh? Welcome to my world, for however long there is one. She felt her face grow warm with shame. Janessa hadn't done anything. She didn't deserve to be thought of so unkindly any more than she deserved to die at Jason's misshapen hands. If she wanted to take things out on somebody, even just silently, the good doctor was a much more appropriate target. Him and his valuable scientific artifact. Suddenly restless, Rowan wandered around the laboratory, hoping a little aimless activity would burn off some of her tension. As long as she could keep from pacing. Pacing drove her nuts, even if she was the one doing it, especially then. She listened to Brodsky rapping out orders and his team replying. The others found his deep, clear voice reassuring. She could tell by the way they all glanced at the console speaker every time they heard it. She wished she could have felt the same way. Picturing the big sergeant in her mind, she was actually tempted to push herself towards that kind of thinking. Even tell herself she knew Brodsky would save them all. Hugging herself, she ambled around near the speaker and then looked up to see Cineron watching her. "I hope they know what they're doing," she blurted before she could stop herself. Cineron nodded confidently. "Hey, these guys live for this stuff." "Then we'd all better hope they don't have to die for it," she thought. She pressed her lips together in hard, bloodless line and only just managed to keep the words in. Having finally finished the word engineers in its entirety, at almost the same moment the string quartet recording ended, Crutch decided that a change in both scene and theme was called for. He swapped the airiness of Mozart for the earthy thump of classic pre-vac rap in his headphone, and with his mind on his money and his money on his mind, Pimp strutted down to the area of the main cargo bay to check on his terrariums. In the beginning, Lou hadn't been thrilled to death at the idea of letting him turn part of the ship into what was in fact a piecemeal miniature greenhouse. When he had first seen the jerry-rigged scaffolding of daylight lamps hang above the collection of transparent globes on their pedestals, Crutch had thought he was going to tell him he had changed his mind and he had 2 minutes to get all that shit off his ship. But then he had just shrugged and said, "Yeah, sure, what the hell. But no ferns in engineering, okay? Or anything else that needs water. A watering can near a control panel, that's just begging fate to fuck you up." As he had started to leave, Crutch had not been able to resist calling after him. "How about silk flowers?" Lou had turned back to him with an exaggerated smile of indulgence. "Silk flowers in engineering, that's just begging me to fuck you up." "What?" Crutch asked incredulously. "Why? Silk flowers don't need water." Lou had made a show of sighing hugely and rolling his eyes. "You ever see silk flowers on the bridge?" "No," Crutch said, even more mystified. "That's right. And do you know why you've never seen silk flowers on the bridge?" Crutch shrugged, shaking his head. Lou gave another huge sigh. "Because silk flowers are fucking tacky. I've got standards, you know." Lost for an answer, Crutch had simply nodded. Lou stared at him a moment longer, and then strolled out, leaving his comm link open so that Crutch could hear him chuckling all the way back to the bridge. Crutch had not hesitated to return the favor after all. It had been a good one. Silk flowers were tacky. He had standards. With that cowboy hat? Crutch was tempted to sneak into his quarters while he was sleeping and add a peyote stitch, hatband, and nice, bright primary colors to the thing. Except one of the things you really didn't want to do was getting to a practical joke war with your pilot. Not if you had half a brain in your head, or even just half a brain cell floating in an alcohol bath plugged into your left ear. Start something like that with a pilot, and that was the rest of your life laid out for you with no going back. There was no calling it off, no time out, no surrender even. No matter what it was, pilots won. They didn't stop, and they did not take prisoners. Granted, with his easygoing temperament and his sense of humor, Lou wasn't your ordinary pilot. But he was a pilot nonetheless, which meant that no matter how general he was, he lived by the pilot's code. The first tenet of which was, thou shalt not fuck with thy pilots. As long as you observed this rule, you were supposed to be perfectly safe. If you didn't bother them, they wouldn't bother you. Something Crutch had always taken for granted. Until he had met Lou, that was. He didn't think that Lou would ever suddenly wake up one day, shift and decide to put itching powder in his thong or mix silk flowers in with the dandelions. But Lou's sense of humor indicated he had a very complex, even devious pattern of thought. It wasn't entirely improbable that he could take it into his head that Crutch's terrariums constituted the opening salvo of some kind of quirky pissing contest simply by the virtue of the way they had joked about it. Well, he was pretty sure most of the time that Lou had been joking about silk flowers being tacky. Just as most of the time, he was pretty sure that any qualms he had about Lou seeing the terrariums as a declaration of war were groundless. His qualms were hydroponic, as it were, which the terrariums themselves were not. Besides, he had to consider the unqualified success of the botany lesson when he had introduced Lou to the best features of dwarf cannabis sativa, which made up in potency what it lacked in size. He'd been generous in supplying Lou with extra materials for further study, as well, and Lou had accepted them gladly. And only then, when it was too late, did he stop to consider the possible hazards of Lou's stones. Well, so far, he was still alive and well and relatively unscathed. Grounds for cautious optimism, at the very least. And really, better he should be too busy being a Renaissance man to worry over minor shit. Ever so often, though, he would get a funny feeling. Like now, when he was all alone in the cargo bay. He straightened up from the workbench where he was laying out a new crop of dwarf cannabis to dry and pulled his headphones down for the first time in several hours. Lou? He asked. Is that you? He shut off the headphones and twisted around on his stool. There was nothing behind him except more terrariums, a few daylight panels on recharge, and a crate of peat that had been picked up on Solaris before they left for Earth 1. Beyond that, nothing but shadows. Lou had a weird frugal streak where energy was concerned. As a result, this was the only well-lit area in the whole cargo bay. The rest usually languished in semi-darkness, something that occasionally got on Crutch's nerves, and not only when he had to grope his way through it. Sometimes, when he was sitting under the daylight lamps, the sight of all that darkness surrounding him was actually kind of unsettling. It was almost like being a character in a horror hollow movie. Crutch shook himself a little in an attempt to literally shake the feeling and told himself he had succeeded. Lou, he said again, louder this time, if that's you, you want to tell me what you're doing? Still no answer. No sound at all of any kind. Nothing to hear, nothing to see. Crutch's imagination suddenly went into overdrive. Was that a slight change in the air, he felt? Lou, I swear to God, he said, raising his voice a little more. You mess with an engineer, you're going to wake up in the morning with a waste hose in your bunk. Nothing. Crutch shrugged. Don't say you weren't warned, Padre, he muttered, putting his earphones back on so Ice-T could resume breaking it down in glorious vulgar detail. If it was Lou creeping around, he'd know it was an empty threat. If it was an empty room, it was an even emptier threat. And if it was an ex-grunt or a student screwing around, they had a date with a waste hose. He started to lean over the plants again when he caught a small movement at the very edge of his peripheral vision on the right. Looking up, he caught sight of the silver picture frame that in the past had displayed a 3-second video in 8x10 photo format of whomever he happened to be married to at the time. As he was between wives, it currently contained a mirror, which he felt was a particularly inspired, albeit obscure, bit of whimsy on his part. Knowing his stool was at the wrong angle, he hadn't expected to see his own face in the glass nor anyone else's. And to be precise, it wasn't a face that he saw reflected there, but an image that might have been vaguely like a face at some time in the past. It was in pretty bad shape, scratched, dirty, dented, even cut into, and devoid of all expression. What the hell? He turned around expecting to find Lou behind him with that piece of shit strapped to his face and just putting his cowboy hat back on. But the guy looming over him didn't have a cowboy hat. He was also way too tall and too massive to be Lou. The thing on his face was splattered and smeared with some kind of wet red stuff that looked an awful lot like blood. Crutch could see there was a lot more of the same goop on the green big knife he was holding up high in his right hand, as if he were preparing to bring it down on something directly in front of him, like, say, a Renaissance man in the chubby form of an engineer/co-pilot. Oh shit, I am screwed, blued, and tattooed. Then out of nowhere, Brodsky's rough, deep voice bellowed, Crutch, get down! He dived for the floor just as the air erupted in a frenzy of deafening explosions, just inches over his head. No, not just over his head. The whole place was exploding. The whole fucking cargo bay and everything in it was going up in big bursts of plastic and glass, dirt and leaves. Sparks were showering down all over the place. And it just went on and on and on, and Jesus, the pain in his ears, the ringing. What the fuck was Brodsky doing? What did he think he was doing? Something thumped hard on the floor only a couple of feet from where he was crouched. Then it blew up, pelting him with clots of damp soil, plant fragments, and gravel. They were killing his terrariums. If this was some kind of fucked up military prank, Crutch thought, suddenly giddy, he would fix it so they all slept with waste hoses for the next 10 years. Then the giddy feeling disappeared, and he knew that a prank was far too much to hope for. Sometime later, he realized that although his ears were still ringing painfully, the explosion themselves seemed to have stopped. Hadn't they? Slowly, he raised his head and found he was curled up under the workbench, hugging one of the legs as if it were the only thing that could save him. It took a great deal of effort to make himself let go, and he might not have come out from underneath the workbench at all if one of Brodsky's men hadn't reached down and hauled him out boldly. The smell of scorched metal and plastic mixed with the stench of something very seriously rotten sent him into a short but intense fit of coughing. "What the hell is going on?" he demanded when he could finally speak. "Just get out of here, now!" Brodsky told him. The expression on his face made Crutch's stomach drop. Even worse, the two soldiers with him looked the same. This was bad. Whatever it was panic time bad. Crutch had only seen people look that way one other time in his life, and he had never thought he would live long enough to see it again. Then his gaze fell on the wreckage that had once been his terrariums. You! Floundering, he turned back to Brodsky and his men. You wrecked all my stuff! Even as he spoke, he knew what an absurd thing it was to say, but he couldn't help it. Go! Brodsky roared at him, and he bolted for the exit. When most of the smoke and dust cleared, Brodsky found himself looking around at his team now gathered in the main cargo bay. All of them were obviously as bewildered as he was. God damn it, said Kicker. We nailed him. I know we did. We fucking nailed him. He's got to be here. Brodsky reloaded and powered up his weapon again. Condor, go high, he said, gesturing at the catwalk. Briggs, through there. He motioned at the perimeter, signaling Gecko and Spin to go with her, then turned to Kicker. Kicker hefted his weapon and nodded. Fully aware now, the monster waited in the darkness. The hunt had begun. Chapter 13. This isn't going to work, Rowan said, watching Lowe's profile tensely. The professor didn't answer or show any sign that he'd even heard her. He only continued leaning on the medical table, staring at nothing, his position unchanged since he had come back from talking to Brodsky in the hallway. She looked around her at the others. None of them said anything. Kensa was still weeping, but the tears were running down her face in complete silence. There was nothing to hear in the lab except the voices of Brodsky and his team in the console speaker as they prowled through the cargo bay. Rowan took a deep, steadying breath and told herself she was only imagining that she could feel how Jason Voorhees had begun the process of picking them off, one by one, in the darkness. Jason Voorhees was the name of the killer moving through the darkness, but only technically, which was to say it was technically a name attributed to that thing hulking through the ship. The minuscule quantity of brain tissue that the sadly deceased Adrian Hart had detected in the killer's skull was far too small for anything beyond the simplest infant-level awareness, but only technically. This only applied to things that came under the category of life. Anti-life was governed by a different set of rules. Jason Voorhees was the name for the consciousness inside the killer in the dark, and this consciousness was not confined to a single, specialized area. Consciousness, along with memory, emotions, and intent, ran through his entire body like an electric current, so that there was no central point of vulnerability. There was no heart to stop, no brain to splatter, and the black fluid that sprayed or splashed or oozed from wounds was nothing remotely like blood. Now the embodiment of anti-life, Jason's Voorhees could feel the presence of each living human. The soldiers moving through the darkness, believing they were hunting him. Other humans huddling together in another room. Someone else sitting alone in the third location. This was no place that he knew. No place and no time. The original world that had made him was gone, and he was now inside something conveying him to a new world. Everything was different, but only technically. As far as he was concerned, nothing had changed. He flexed his fingers and took a better grip on the big blade in his hands.
"Briggs, anything?"
Brodsky's voice rasped in her headphones. "Negative," Briggs said as she moved soundlessly through the narrow space between the largest, heaviest pieces of cargo and the wall. Shit, but she'd never realized what a maze the bay was when it was full. You could run a sim down here without bothering to load an environment module, just the monsters. Except today, you wouldn't need those either. Dallas's face, as she had last seen it, bloody and broken, appeared in her mind and she shut it out, squelching the pang that had come with it. Later for that, goddammit. Right now, there was a corner coming up just ahead, and she had to concentrate if she wanted to be alive after she turned it. Behind her, she heard the sound of Gecko hefting her BFG, and under that, Sven's footsteps, and she let herself feel reassured.
"Condor, anything topside?"
"Negative, Sarge," came the answer. "There's no sign of him." Rowan didn't realize she had been holding her breath until it came out of her in a rush. "This isn't going to work," she said to Lowe again, more urgently this time. "I've got everything under control," he snapped at her. Startled, she took a step back. Did he really believe that? She looked around at the rest of the group, still silent, their frightened faces turned to the console speaker as they listened to the soldiers hunt for Jason. "Where the hell's Sven?" said a woman's voice. Hunt for Jason? Oh God, even if they knew better than to believe Lowe or even Brodsky could have everything under control, they probably really did think that they were hunting Jason and not vice versa. Suddenly she had a powerful urge to jump on the radio and tell them all they weren't hunting Jason, that nobody ever hunted Jason because nobody could. Jason was the hunter. Everyone else was the prey, and they had to get out of there before Jason could pick them all off. There was a crunching noise in the speakers then, like something breaking very slowly. Rowan saw Janessa put a hand to her mouth as KM crossed the room to be closer to the console. This was followed by the loud clang of metal striking metal, and a series of short, effortful grunts, the sound of a man who had met an enemy in the dark and was now fighting for his life.
"Condor? Anything topside?"
"Negative, Sarge," Condor said. "There's no sign of him." He had barely finished answering when the son of a bitch was right there, looming over him like he had just materialized out of nowhere. One moment he had been scanning the area, sweeping his BFG from side to side, and the next the figure was looming over him so close he couldn't even get his weapon up into firing position. Condor had just enough time to register his upraised hand and the knife, blood dripping from the shiny metal descending rapidly towards his face. He flung himself into a backwards roll and felt the sweep of air as the knife missed him by inches and clanged against the catwalk railing. Before his attacker could recover, Condor bounced up in one smooth motion and planted a vicious savate kick directly under the bastard's chin, right below that fucking mask. The guy was about a foot taller than he was, but the blow should have put him down. Condor had never met anyone who could stand up to a hit like that, but the son of a bitch didn't even stagger. The hell with that, Condor thought, and let loose on the guy's midsection with a combination of jabs guaranteed to liquefy the internal organs. No armor under those rags, but definitely something weird about the guy's torso. It was like punching a sack of something like potatoes and bones, and he should have gone down with the rupture and blood coming out of his mouth, or at least the holes in the mask where his mouth would be. But he barely took a step back. The son of a bitch was still standing like Condor was, no more than a fly bashing itself against him. Screw this sideways, Condor thought fiercely, and drove his elbow into the hollow at the base of the breastbone. At that same moment, rotating his arm upward so his fist caught the guy right in the mask. His head jerked slightly, and Condor noticed for the first time that his skull was irregular and lumpy, as if the bone had been broken and rebroken and then allowed to heal any old way it wanted. Only that was not what happened when somebody got their head broken over and over. A knife-edged chop with the blade of his hand didn't even turn the guy's head. Condor rounded on him and elbowed him in the jaw. The bastard didn't even stagger. He was about to try another kick when the guy finally raised one arm and, swinging it in an almost casual way, backhanded him right over the railing of the catwalk. Ah, screw me sideways, Condor thought as he felt himself drop. 30 feet down to a metal floor with no give to it was going to make scrambled eggs out of his spine. And speaking of scrambled eggs, oh shit, the back of his head. He wasn't wearing a helmet, and sure, the ants could fix him up, but oh shit, this was gonna hurt. This was gonna hurt bad, and then, impossibly, something caught him in midair before he hit the floor. Everything stopped. He blinked up at the bastard on the catwalk, and the impassive mask stared back. Was this what happened when you died, he wondered? In the very last second before the end, everything just went freeze frame? Oh shit, for how long? Just till your body finished dying so you could move on to whatever was coming up next? Or, oh shit, was this forever? Was he really going to have to spend eternity staring at this big motherfucker in a mask who had killed him? Who was that masked motherfucker? Dunno, he didn't leave his motherfucking name. He just killed my ass. Oh shit, this was so fucking unfair. All at once, the entire scene above him, the guy, the mask, the catwalk, and the shadowy ceiling beyond, began to rotate slowly in a clockwise direction. Okay, now this was just too friggin' weird, Condor thought. A mild wave of nausea passed through him, as his view of the bastard on the catwalk made one complete rotation and went into another without a pause. He started to take a deep breath to counter it and felt his diaphragm hit something hard and immovable, something that shouldn't have been there at all. He barely had a moment to be puzzled before the pain hit him in the exact same spot, a terrible searing as if something had not only run through but torn up his insides in the process. The tip of one of the mole's four drill bits came into focus then. As he had sharpened the things many times, he knew right away what he was looking at. Although he didn't know what all that gooey wet stuff on it was, or where it had come from. But then, as everything continued to twirl, he did know. He knew everything he had to know, including the fact that it would be best now to die quickly. "Just keep your eyes peeled," Brodsky told Condor. No answer. Not even a copy that. Brodsky frowned, glancing at Kicker. Kicker hefted the BFG he was holding and looked questioningly at him. Brodsky gestured at the shadows off to the right. Kicker nodded once and vanished into them.
"Sven,"
Brodsky rasped into his comm.
"Condor."
"Can't find them, Sarge," Briggs answered.
"God damn it!"
Brodsky tapped the link to make sure all the channels were open, even though he already knew they were.
"Sven, report! Condor, report! I said report! That's an order!"
For a few seconds, he heard nothing but the sound of dead air over multiple channels. Then Briggs spoke again.
"Sarge, we found Condor."
They hadn't used the mole once during the whole trip. It had just sat there in the cargo bay, taking up space. Every time Brodsky ran out of keep busy assignments, he'd tell Condor to sharpen the drill bits. Always Condor, because he was the only one of them who could grind metal for longer than 60 seconds without going crazy. Nerves of steel or no nerves at all. Nobody knew which, and the man himself had declined to say. Now they'd never know, Briggs thought, staring up at Condor's body skewered on the drill bit. For her part, she couldn't decide whether it had been a good thing that the metal had been sharp or not. As a general rule, a sharp blade hurt a lot less than a dull one. But she had no idea if that applied to something with a pointed end and an edge that spiraled the length of a central shaft. She couldn't see how it would not have been painful to die twirling around on a coil of metal stuck through your gut,
no matter how sharp it was. She hoped that Condor had died too quickly to see his innards trailing along the cutting edge. Her gaze fell on Gecko standing on the other side of the mole. Her elegant, sculpted features were set in a stony expression, and there was murder in her eye. Briggs took a breath before she spoke into her comm. "Sarge, we found Condor." "What's his condition?" Brodsky asked her. She had to take another breath before she could answer. "He's screwed." Her gaze met Gecko's. The other woman stared back hard, and it occurred to Briggs fleetingly that they might have been daring each other to laugh. Then Gecko stood up a little straighter. "Let's smoke this motherfucker." Briggs nodded and they moved off, their paths diverging in the darkness. Kicker took a firmer grip on his BFG as he moved along the side of the large metal cube that contained the extra armaments. They probably should have armed all the students before they'd gone hunting this bastard, he thought. Or maybe they should have put all the students in the shuttle, got in with them, and hit the panic button, gambling that when they dropped out of hyperspace, they would find themselves in a zone with a reasonable amount of regular traffic, and not the ass end of East Nowhere. The sound of Gecko's voice in his comm made him jump. "I found Sven." Pause. "He's dead." Kicker wiped his mouth with the back of one hand. Jesus, this was one busy son of a bitch. Or was it just one? Could there have actually been more than one running loose on this ship? Sure, he'd seen with his own eyes that they'd only brought two on board, but that didn't mean they couldn't have picked up a hitchhiker or two without knowing it. The shuttle's perimeter alarms had been down while they boarded, and Lou probably hadn't bothered to put them back up before liftoff. According to the gospel, according to Lou, the frugal, it was a big waste of energy flipping alarms on and off and on, especially on a dead planet. Maybe Mr. Frugal had decided to make even bigger savings by not putting the perimeter alarms on in the first place. So while they were underground being impressed with themselves for finding two viables in cryo, there could have been two or three more from some other underground facility, already thawed out and ready for action. They could have already been hidden in the shuttle by the time his ass had hit the co-pilot's seat next to Luke, and nobody would have known. His thoughts were interrupted by an ugly, gargling noise. "Who's there?" Kicker whispered into his comm. "Briggs! Gecko!" The noise came again, louder and uglier, and it was coming not just from his comm now, but from somewhere in front of him. He had heard that sound many times before, always in certain combat situations, and he knew exactly what it meant. The flashlight strapped to his BFG caught a movement several yards ahead of him. He crouched low, steadying the light, and waited with his finger on the trigger. The figure that finally appeared in the circle of light took several uneven steps toward him on tiptoe, one arm stretched out in a wordless plea for help, as air and blood bubbled out of the deep slash in her throat. "Gecko!" Her name came out of Kicker like a moan as he rushed forward just in time to catch her as she pitched forward. He lowered her gently to the floor, trying to ignore the terrible, final sound of blood blowing out of her throat as she struggled to breathe. "Ah, shit," he said, looking into her eyes and begging her not to die. "Gecko!" He felt her hand start to clutch his shoulder. Then suddenly it went limp and dropped to the floor, her knuckles rapping hard on the metal. Air rushed out of her in a final, gargling sigh, sending some of her blood into his face in a fine mist. "Oh, shit," he said again miserably and let go of her. "Sarge, it's Gecko. She's..." There was a flash of metal on his right, and he looked up to see the hostile, standing only a few feet away. Gecko's blood was still dripping from the blade in his hand. Kicker was on his feet, firing before he was even aware of putting his finger on the trigger, and hollering at the top of his lungs as if that would double the force of each round that he put into that big son of a bitch. The hostile staggered back, a multitude of explosions punching holes in him, and then punching holes in the holes already there. Blood and chunks of flesh flew in all directions. Kicker kept firing, unaware either that he was still roaring in unchecked fury, or that he was now advancing on the bastard as well. He was unaware of anything except how much he wanted to put the motherfucking son of a bitch bastard down. Abruptly, the figure keeled over backwards. Kicker stopped firing just in time to hear a sound like someone stabbing a large bag of wet garbage. He moved closer, shining his flashlight on the place where the hostile had fallen.
For half a second, the sight in front of him made no sense at all. Then his head cleared and he saw one of the grappling hook blades protruding from the center of the bastard's chest. All right! He was slinging his weapon when his gaze fell on a set of controls within easy reach of his left hand. Even better, he thought, and slammed his fist down on a large green button. Immediately, the grappling hook began to ascend, taking the hostile with it, coming to a stop 10 feet up. "Sarge, I got it," he shouted into the comm. "Repeat, I got the motherfucker. You copy?"
"I copy. On my way."
Brodsky sounded as if he were talking with clenched teeth.
"Don't take your eyes off it. You copy that?"
For answer, Kicker put a few more rounds into the hostile's dangling legs, making sure he got the kneecaps. Now, even if the son of a bitch turned into a zombie, he wouldn't be chasing anyone around. Not with shattered kneecaps.
"Take your time, Sarge," Kicker drawled, turning his back on his trophy. "He ain't going nowhere."
In Lab 1, Rowan covered her face with both hands. Oh God, he hadn't really just said that, had he? Everyone else in the lab was talking at once, happy and relieved and sure they were safe, but Rowan heard none of it. He might as well have said, "I'll be right back," in an old 80s or 90s horror movie. She stood with her ear close to the console speaker, waiting for the inevitable. She didn't have to wait for long. The scream was even worse than she had expected. But that was the thing about Jason. No matter how bad you thought anything was going to be, it would always be worse. No matter how hard you tried to prepare yourself, you simply couldn't. She pressed her tightly folded hands against her lips as if she were trying to keep a scream of her own in, even though she knew she wasn't going to scream yet. Not yet, but sometime soon. Much sooner than she'd have liked.
"Briggs!" came a hoarse, agonized whisper. "Briggs, get out of here!"
Rowan clenched her hands tighter, waiting for Briggs to answer. No, waiting for everyone to realize that Briggs wasn't going to answer, ever.
"Briggs, where the hell are you?"
demanded Brodsky. Rowan closed her eyes.
"Where do you think?" "Briggs, answer me! Where the hell..."
Brodsky's voice cut off sharply. There was some kind of unidentifiable background noise, followed by a heavy sigh.
"Oh, Briggs! God damn it!"
Rowan opened her eyes and looked at Lo in alarm.
"He's all alone in there!"
Lo blinked at her, baffled.
"Brodsky," she said, her heart pounding too fast and too hard. "Brodsky's all alone in there, Lo!"
Waylander appeared at her side, looking from her to the speaker and back again, as if to ask if she were sure. She nodded, almost imperceptibly, and he turned to Lo, who raised up her temporary hand to foretell any questions or comments. The student turned back to her and then looked around at the others, but no one else had anything to say, and the silence in the lab remained unbroken until Brodsky spoke again.
"Okay, you son of a bitch,"
Brodsky muttered, keeping his back against the wall as he moved slowly forward. He was going to keep circling the perimeter with his back to the wall until the hostile came at him. Hours or days, it didn't matter. The motherfucker was not going to sneak up behind him. If he wanted to eat Elijah Brodsky's lunch, he was going to have to come at him straight on, face to face. And then Elijah Brodsky was going to cut out his heart and show it to him, and then put it back in and cut it out again over and over, once for each member of his team. Now how the rat fuck bastard liked that kind of treatment? And if Lo had a problem with that, he'd ask the professor how he'd like a little heart surgery himself. He reached the door between the main cargo bay and the utility room that served as storage for spare parts and pods, thinking hard. Take a look. If there had been anyone left to watch his back, he wouldn't have hesitated. Instead, he used his security code to double lock it from the outside. Now anyone in there couldn't get out, and anyone who wanted to get in was shit out of luck. He took a moment to top up the ammo in his sidearm and then got moving again. His back was right against the center of the door that he had just locked when something exploded out from it right next to his head. A moment later, something hard and thick had wrapped itself around his neck. An arm, he realized. It was an arm. A motherfucking, fucking arm, strangling him. It had punched right through the metal door, and it was strangling him from behind. From fucking behind. Brodsky flailed wildly, gasping and choking. The muscles in the arm had no give to them. Whatever they were made of, it wasn't flesh, Brodsky thought absently. He pulled at it anyway, fighting for breath. All at once, he felt a slight shift in the arm's position, and an even slighter let up in the pressure against his windpipe. He sucked in as much air as he could, preparing to take advantage. Then something punched him squarely in the kidney. He heard himself bellow with surprise and pain. At the same time, the arm around his neck loosened even more and was replaced by a hand large enough to span his throat. Brodsky went to pull himself free and discovered that he was stuck to the door. How the fuck? By his kidney. Then he looked down and saw that he was actually nailed to the door by a long, nasty blade with vicious saw teeth, which he was pretty sure had passed through his kidney. Shit, he growled. It's gonna take more than a little poke in the ribs to bring this old dog down. Immediately, he felt what seemed like a hand punched to his other kidney. He didn't have to look down to know what it really was, but he was curious. Not another knife, but something like a metal pipe, poking a good 2 feet out of his torso. Yup, he said, staring down at the pointy end sadly. That ought to do it! What the fuck did anybody need a fucking pike on a starship for anyway? Brodsky wondered, as everything faded to black. Okay, this has been action-packed chapters 12 and 13 of Jason X. I really enjoyed tonight's chapters. I hope you guys did as well. I know it's playing right along with the movie. I keep saying this, but it really is an enjoyable novel. With the past few chapters, I can completely forgive all the filler that came earlier in the novel. And I can just tell from here on out, there's not going to be much filler. They just can't. We're only halfway through the movie, and we've only got like 130 pages left of the book, a 400-page book. So from here on out, I think things are going to stay interesting. Let me know what you guys think of the book so far, parallel to the movie itself. Some of my subscribers know this, but Jason X, unapologetically, is my favorite Jason movie. I'm going to get a lot of shit from that for that probably. But the reason I say this is, like, my second favorite is Part 4, and then my third is Part 6. But Jason X has all the formula of a Friday the 13th movie. But it's also an original concept for the series. And it wasn't done cheesy in a sense that it tried to take itself seriously. The movie knew that it was cheese, that it was sci-fi cheese mixed with the slasher horror. But it stayed true to Friday the 13th. It stayed true to Jason Voorhees. You know, yeah, we weren't at a camp with counselors, but we're on a spaceship with teenagers. You know, okay, I'm not going to defend myself. Jason X, in my opinion, is a fun, good Jason movie. And I love it. And I'm really enjoying this book. I've enjoyed the other two Jason X books so far. And I'm looking forward to reading the last two Jason X books after this one. So let me know in the comments section what you guys think. And I'll be back soon with some more of Jason X. And until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, yup, that ought to do it. The floor, let the bodies hit the floor, let the bodies hit the floor.